Welcome to Scared Yet, this horror roundtable, a discussion of horror in games. I was going to do it on, I realized that, like, horror in the media might have been a broader topic, so let's go ahead and just change it. Because I wanted us to discuss what we enjoy, why we enjoy it, maybe how we came to it, because I don't really understand why I like it. Because it seems like the thing that, as a child, I would have been steered away from. Because my parents, my parents were horror people. What?
It's fun being scared.
We'll get into that for sure. You sound like you have a lot of ideas.
I have a few thoughts about horror games.
Let's go down and if we would all introduce ourselves.
So, I'm Rim, I'm a podcaster, and I realized this is my 39th PAX panel. I realized that a little while ago. So, I do a podcast on games, and I like do lectures on game theory, and I do consulting for game design for a lot of different companies. I'm also the executive producer of Date Naito, which makes visual novels and that sort of thing.
You do that?
Yeah, I do that.
I did not know
that. Yeah, my friend Connor Crayley.
Interesting.
I'm Alanah
Pearce,
I'm an editor at IGN in San Francisco. I also have a silly YouTube channel where I sometimes play scary games.
I am on a Twitch channel where I play scary games every Friday through a site called Loading Ready Run.
What's your name?
My name's Alex. Thank you.
My name is Dave Allen, and I'm a designer for Penny Arcade. And I play scary games on YouTube occasionally.
And I'm Kris Straub, and I'm a cartoonist primarily, but I also play games on a podcast called 28 Plays Later. And I also am the author of Candle Cove, the creepypasta. And I'm very interested in horror, you guys. But why? We started and we're like, let's save it for the panel.
Yeah.
Because you said that when you were, like, your parents plied you with horror material.
So the first big boy book I ever read was The Hobbit. Like, that was the first one. The second one was Stephen King's Skeleton Crew.
Not me.
Which is Stephen King, like you think today, like is a certain kind of genre, but his early short fiction was very existential and weird. Like there was one that terrified me as a kid, just Where the Deer Are. And it's literally a girl's walking to school and there's no people, there's only deer.
Whoa.
And that's it.
Yeah.
That's freaky.
I think she turned into a deer.
She was a deer. She was going to deer school.
Oh, dear.
The first book. The first book.
You lob up that one right over the plate.
I know. The first books that I, like, they were just on my dad's shelves were those old Lovecraft paperbacks. And I read them, I was probably like 10. But I read them, I thought of them in the way that, like, you might read, like, classic literature. Like, there's C.S. Lewis on the shelf and Jack London on the shelf. And I just thought of them as, well, this is just more... You know, you probably read this in junior high and write reports about it. Like, I didn't realize that this is actually weird fiction that is, at the time, had less of a...
I did, and the teachers in my middle school actually called my parents to ask what was wrong with me.
Was there anything wrong with them?
So what was the outcome?
To be decided.
I remember very clearly being terrified of VHS horror movie box art.
Yes.
And two titles in particular, like, they rattled me so bad through my childhood. One was Future Kill, because H.R. Giger did the design, and it's like this sort of cyber demon monster, just sort of like with his spine fingers over his face, and I was just like, okay. And the other one was The Serpent and the Rainbow, which has the tagline, "Don't bury me, I'm not dead." And a dude with, like, you know, this... white as a sheet complexion and like this crucifix like painted in blood on his forehead leaning out of a casket being like no, and it scared the bejesus out of me.
Yeah.
Until I watched it like 5 years ago and I was like, this is garbage. It was a very affirming sort of experience. It was like, oh, what the hell was I afraid of?
Well, that's something we can get into later, the whole like kids and adults like experience things very differently. Beetlejuice to a kid is a horror movie.
Yeah.
I didn't realize it was a comedy until I was an adult. Like, when I was 20 and I watched it again.
I was terrified of one of the Batman movies, the one where Jim Carrey was the Joker. Is it Batman or not?
Really? Yeah.
So when I watched that as a kid, I was so scared of Jim Carrey, that I lost myself in a bathroom and cried. And I couldn't watch it. And then I went back to watch it like maybe 2 years ago, and I was like, this is a terrible film, and it's also not scary at all. But I just couldn't handle it.
Oh man, did anybody see Secret of Nim?
Yeah, I think
that movie messed me up.
Yeah.
When like the third Miss Frisbee's house is sinking and there's all the mud and they're gonna drown, it's like.
I remember being afraid of Troll 2. I thought it was Ernest Scared Stupid with the trolls, right? Which
yeah.
is still pretty kind of stupid.
You also reminded me of Ernest Scared Stupid.
Well,
it's the best Ernest P. Worrell movie, like hands down.
That's the one where he kills the troll monster by kissing it?
No,
and then it blows up?
They're allergic to milk.
Milk is what they are.
Or Miak.
Miak. What?
You haven't seen that movie recently,
no,
have you?
No, I remember it. It's in my brain.
So this is our panel. how did this stuff influence what you found? Like the cool thing of enjoying a horror movie, enjoying a horror game, like they're very different because horror places you there. And I feel like that makes it potentially more effective. But how have these things influenced what you sought out? Like what channels of horror, what types? You know what I mean?
For me, it's interesting because I had this sort of like classical tutelage of horror because my family was so deeply into like horror fiction. Like I read a lot of like contemporary horror fiction just on a day-to-day basis. And I found that because I studied it from that sort of perspective, I very rapidly went into a like existential horror or sort of not realistic like bloody violence, gory horror, but like one of my favorite short stories. It's a horror story, recent one, about a man who walks out into the tidal flats to see some birds and he doesn't realize the tide's coming in behind him and then it's too late. And it's terrifying, and there's no ghost, it's just a man coming to terms with the fact that he's going to die, and there's nothing he can do about it while the birds are watching him.
I want more video games like that. Because, I mean, most of them are just sort of like a jack-in-the-box with a demon inside. It's like, boing, oh no, well, better get the rocket launcher.
Do you remember Doom 3?
Yeah.
And you had to do the flashlight versus the
first
gun
round of mods that came out were like duct tape. Because why can you only hit it?
Yeah.
I think it was a great idea on paper, but it just didn't work. It was like, this is stupid.
The problem was
gun or flashlight, but not both.
The real problem with that game was that the best horror in video games, in my perspective, are the like disenfranchisement horror, where you are disempowered as a character and there are forces of nature out to get you. That game was, you're Doom Guy. You're invincible, and things are jumping at you, but you're Doom Guy. You've got a shotgun.
You can't be afraid of something you've been one-shot with a railgun. It's like, oh, it's you.
Well, I thought, like, you get, once it had, you know, revealed its tricks very early on, like, it was a very much, I know the door's shut, and there's going to be something back there. Like, you understood its rhythms, and now they're all fears removed.
Of course, then look at a game like Five Nights at Freddy's that has the same thing. There's a very specific rhythm to it. But then every night, it breaks one of its own rules. Mm-hmm. So you go through that, you know, the classic horror cycle of there's dread, anticipation, climax, and then safety. And you kind of up and down and up and down and up and down to climax. So in Doom, it was like the cycle was very, very specific to the whole game and it never deviated. But Five Nights at Freddy's, every night, you feel like you're safe because you've got the game. And then, that one works differently. Foxy works differently. Freddy works differently. So the game keeps like going into the save room and hitting you.
Yeah.
I think one of my favorite games full stop is Silent Hill PT. I'm super passionate about PT. And I think even talking about it now, it still is like one of those jack-in-the-box kind of things where you're just in a house and then there's this thing that just jumps out occasionally, and even if it's in the same place, every time I play it through, I still scream. But it's because you don't have any power in that circumstance, I don't think she ever stops being scary. Until you get to the last puzzle, which is just bullshit.
Did you have to like stand in a mirror and like whisper a name at the right time and it never
worked?
No,
actually, I finished it without a microphone.
Wow.
Yeah.
I guess I was just being stupid and whispering into a microphone.
I love like the idea of not needing to finish it with a microphone and people are in their houses like, Emily, Jesse, talk to me, Lisa.
Oh, man. Video games, horror video games with bullshit endings. There's so many of them.
We can, let's get in there because...
Who played Outlast?
You finished Outlast?
Yes. That game,
first 6 minutes,
I think, is really, really great, and I loved it until the ending. Because
nanomachines, son,
is how that game ends. And it's like, what?
That might be
nice. It heard me talking shit about it.
Well, Phantasmagoria, there's an old game. Phantasmagoria was in the era of multimedia games where this game came on 7 CDs, and it was basically just a terrible, like, adventure game with actors, like B-movie actors, made by the same people who made Dragon Quest, or not Dragon Quest, King's Quest.
Yeah.
But the end was, oh, there's actually a demon, and it, like, comes out of the ground, and there's this big fight scene where you fight the demon, and then the end, and then it plays a really bad movie soundtrack as you walk away from the credits, and it was just...
I can't stand it when they sort of, like, flip it at the end. It's like, suddenly, big combat, because it kind of, in some ways, just robs all the anticipation, sort of, like, horror, and like, oh, I don't know what this thing is, it's after me. Oh, it's a monster, and I have to deplete its meat points, and then it'll go away.
Yeah, well, so to get back to Chris's original question, the kind of horror that I like the most is the stuff where I don't understand what is haunting me.
Yeah.
So it's like, if I don't understand whatever the thing is, as soon as you show me the bad guy, I can make fun of the bad guy, so the bad guy's not so scary anymore.
Right.
So I'm like, what are you, dumb face? It makes me feel super brave. But in Until Dawn, there's like the first like half of that game, I really don't want to spoil anything, but what you think is the bad guy is like flipped on its head, and then you're introduced to this different bad guy, and figuring that out is really fun, and I think that's a really good example of something that kind of flips on its end, because you have no idea what's going on for a large chunk of that game in a way that makes you kind of have to evolve with that in terms of gameplay and the decisions that you make. So I think that that's really well done.
Did any of you play Oxenfree?
Yes, I love Oxenfree. Can we talk about it for the rest of the panel?
Yes.
There's like, I'm trying to thread this like I'm in a moderating capacity, but I have no.
But Oxenfree,
no. We have to talk about Oxenfree.
What is Oxenfree?
So it's an indie game, but it's like an adventure game. It's really pretty, and the art is very, like, it's beautiful. It's very simplistic too, very cartoony. The music is sort of like 80s. I don't want to say horror synth, but it's very synth heavy. It's very it's really, really good, and it's all dialogue driven. So there's a lot of emphasis on characters, right? But to go back to something that you said, Alex, about VHS artifacts, which is a device in Oxenfree.
That's true. I haven't finished the game, but I've gotten a little further than halfway through.
Have you done the Hangman thing?
Yes, that scared the shit out of me. There's so many parts, and like you described, I don't know what I'm up against.
Yeah.
I still have no idea of what the threat is,
yeah.
What its shape is, what it wants. And I'm so afraid of it. It's like,
In a really impressive way, even after the end of Oxenfree, you're still asking those kinds of questions.
Yeah.
So it like gives you closure, but even when you finish it, there's still like, what is that?
Well, like the game makes you do things that you're like, oh, this is a thing that is helping, but wait, am I actually making it worse instead?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it totally tricks you in a really cool way as well.
Yeah.
It's great. I don't know if I would classify that as horror.
I think it is.
It's scary,
but
I think.
It's Twilight Zone, if that's the genre.
Yeah.
I've played so many horror games that I've started to sort of discern flavors out of them. So there's games that are, like, terrifying, you know, which is the demon in the jack-in-the-box thing. Like, a big slavering monster, like, stomps after you. That's terrifying. You're scared. A game like Oxenfree is more sort of, like, spooky, where it's, like, the atmosphere, the unknown, you're, like, kind of off balance, and there's other games like Rule of Rose, which is really disturbing. It's just like the people are the scary part of that game. Just like,
man is the real monster.
Did anyone play Everybody's Gone to the Rapture?
I did, yeah.
So for whatever reason, I found that really creepy.
Anyone
doesn't know, Everybody's Gone to the Rapture is just a game where you walk or run, which I found out very late through playing it, unfortunately. You walk around this completely empty town, and you come across these things that let you sort of replay scenes, but everyone's gone, and you're kind of trying to figure out where they went. But for whatever reason, being in a town that has absolutely nobody in it is really eerie, even though there's no apparent threat, and there's never any indication that anything's going to hurt you. It's just super creepy.
What's
because it's so foreign. Yeah, it was always tense, and I don't really know why.
So I saw a bunch of people online, Gone Home is just, it's a very, it's not a horror game,
yeah.
But
people who didn't read a lot about Gone Home and played it blind as soon as they're walking around by themselves in a house for a while, a lot of them thought it was a horror game and were really unnerved and afraid, and it took a while for them to realize that nothing was going to jump out and get them.
Yeah.
Like, oh,
except Felix.
Love story. I don't know what I was afraid of. I think someone should do a mod for that game that adds one random jump scare.
Not a mod, a virus.
Like, oh, this is great, and it's,
no, it's like a
pretty fast scare.
Yeah. Just
in the end.
I thought the thing that I had read about that I was going to bring up too is that, like, people who, like, traditionally don't play games played Gone Home, you know, the way it's, you know, exploring and reading about these people. But people who were familiar with games, like the fact that it's an empty house and all that, it's the cadence of a horror game.
That's the difference in that cycle between dread and expectation or anticipation. Dread is, I'm unnerved, you know, because of music and sound cues and whatever. But expectation is in, you know, one of those adventure survival horror games where you turn the corner and you see a long hallway with lockers. And one of the lockers
dead
is
space.
Closed.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Every damn hallway in Dead Space, I'm like, you can jump out of that, it's fine. Oh, it's infuriating.
Yeah, like you say, it has all the horror game setups with none of the payoffs, which just makes you more and more and more nervous. It's like, when's the other shoe going to drop, man? I can't deal with this. I mean, anticipation, I think, is a really important mechanic in, like, any kind of horror.
Especially when you then use it to, like, in Resident Evil, while that's really not a horror game, it just has a lot of, like, genre horror trappings, there's a few times where you walk past a window and nothing happens. You expect dogs to jump through, but nothing happens. And then stuff happens, and like 10 minutes later, you walk past the same window, and then it happens.
Yeah. Do you feel like, speaking of, do you feel like jump scares are cheap or effective?
Both.
Because here's the thing. I don't have a very good startle response. Like, and so it does not work on me.
Did you play Five Nights at Freddy's? Like, even that one?
No, I didn't play that one yet.
So it does. So I have this, like, hour-long video essay I did a while ago on Five Nights at Freddy's and, like, the mechanics of the game and why it scares people the way it does. But the gist of it is that the game, like, it's a very technical game of, like, open the door, close the door, count the stuff. So it forces you to pay attention real hard. So you keep, like, leaning in closer and closer to the monitor. So it's almost like the clown's, like, beckoning you closer, and then he gets you. So the game, the more you concentrate, the more invested you are, the blinders keep coming in, and then the game jump scares you.
Well, the thing about Five Nights at Freddy's is there's one jump scare. You know it's coming, and you just have to try and avoid it. Which is unbelievably stressful and why I can't play those games. I played the first one, I was like, this is great, I love it. I'm glad it exists. I never want to play these ever again as long as I live.
But that is why the jump scare is, I think that's a good one, because a lot of games like Resident Evil, a jump scare happens to, oh my god, jump scare in the middle of the game to remind you it's a horror game.
Yeah.
Five Nights at Freddy's, it ends the game. It's almost the reward. It's like being in the haunted house. You kind of want the jump scare because it releases the tension. It's the only way out of the game other than beating it. So it's more like the game's blinders put someone who wouldn't normally be scared in a haunted house in the situation where your body forgets that you're an adult who knows that these things aren't real, and then it jump scares you.
Maybe now I have to play it and see if it will ping me there.
It's worth playing.
Yeah. Just don't read about it. Like, don't try to be good at it. Like, people who do, like, live stream, like, run-throughs, like, time attacks, it's
no.
Don't find any pro strats for Five Nights at Freddy's.
Why would you want to do that for a game like this?
To be an
LG?
I think the effectiveness or, I don't know, success of jump scares varies depending on the game. So Until Dawn totally overuses them in a way that you have them all the time in similar circumstances and I'm just like, again? But, I mean, they work on me every time. I had fun, like, I was filming that on YouTube and picking their thumbnails, just playing through it with my mum. I would pick thumbnails in every episode where our faces were like,
yes.
And it just, every time was so easy to find because they always work, but I was just getting tired. I was like, constantly expecting them to be there and they weren't very good. It would just be like something fell over and I'd be like, ah! One point there's like they're in an abandoned house and this raccoon comes out of the cupboard. What was it eating? How did it get in there? The house has been empty for a really long time. Why is there a raccoon there? And it leaves and no one ever mentions it ever again. Like this is a complete waste of time.
Yeah.
Like it scared me, but it didn't add anything to the game. It just scared me. And I like felt like that was really cheap. But if it's in like I think Five Nights at Freddy's is a perfect example of how to use them right.
Yeah, I think the idea is like to use them sparingly.
Yeah.
And Five Nights at Freddy's uses it extremely sparingly because there's one in the whole game.
Yeah.
It's a different one sometimes, but, you know, it's just, you use it every once in a while and keep people waiting, and then you're like, no.
Well, it also very cleverly, like, you talked about how when you know the mechanics, you figure them out. Like, because, you know, when you play a game, you make a mental model of the game, like a heuristic in your head. When you figure out the model, it's hard to be afraid of it anymore.
Yeah.
Right. Five Nights at Freddy's, it's a very simple set of heuristics that make the game work, but it doesn't tell you them. So you don't really know how the game actually works. The game doesn't tell you, I won't really spoil stuff, but, like, there's things you can do that avoid jump scares. Only because you don't understand how it's really working. If you do it wrong, they're in the room with you already and it's too late. Like, at one point you go to click on the button to close the door and it doesn't work anymore. And you don't know why. You're like, keep clicking on the button. Like, wait, why isn't the button working? And you're kind of weirded out about it. And then you have to keep playing the game and then that you're already dead at that point. It's going to get you. It's just a matter of when. And the when is triggered by an action you do, or it's random, so you can't figure it out.
Well, that's just mean.
Yeah.
Well, like, throwing the player off balance is really effective for keeping them horrified. It's a form of disempowerment. It's like, you can't effectively wield your skill to avoid, you know, these things happening to you. Although that's a tough line to tread, because you can end up just frustrating the player.
You also have to make them think that they could figure it out, or that they have figured it out, and then remind them that they haven't.
Which, again, total opposite of Silent Hill PT. You get to the end, and it's like, by the way, walk 10 paces.
Yeah.
What?
What happens if I walk 10 paces?
I feel like
a baby laughs.
Yeah.
It's ridiculous.
Beat it. Just a little achievement pops up.
But I think Five Nights at Freddy's uses jump scares as a punishment for dying. Silent Hill PT kind of does the same, except for the few moments where she's in a window or she's in a hallway. I think that is a pretty good use if it's your punishment for doing something wrong is being scared. I think that's cool.
Well, it's sinister, though, because you start conditioning you. It's like training your body. Think about that. Like, Five Nights at Freddy's, like, when I was playing it a lot to do that video, like, I had to figure out all the mechanics, like, really mess with it. And I was playing all four of the games, and it got to the point to where I'd know it was coming, and I was, like, paralyzed. Like, I would start to react before it happened, because my brain was trained that the action I just did when I pulled the mouse down is going to make a jump scare appear, and there's nothing I can do to stop it.
There was one time when I was playing Until Dawn where I expected a jump scare, so I just looked below the screen. And I'd be like, yeah, it's going to come. Oh, there it is. And then there was one time where I actually didn't react, so I was looking kind of at the floor, and I could still see it in my peripherals, and I was like, yeah! Do anything to me.
There's a moment in Five Nights where there'll be a timer on one of the jump scares where, like, you hear footsteps and then it gets you. But okay, like 1 in 10 times, the footsteps will happen and then the jump scare won't happen for like 30 more seconds. So I have a video of myself literally being like, did the game crash? And then it got me. I was looking down like, I'm not going to get jump scared, and it like tricked me into looking back up and got me.
I had that same experience playing with Layers of Fear, which is it's like this indie game that came out of nowhere.
Okay, Batman.
You're wandering around basically a nightmare of, like, this painter. And there is some weird, creepy stuff going on. And there's a nightmare sequence where, like, the room is spinning and there's all these, like, things leering at you. You're like, and, you know, it goes on and on and on. And then it's over. And you're like, okay, there's the release. And you go open the door and there's a baby head the size of, like, God.
Oh yeah.
And the replay, I'm talking about, like, I get to this part and then I start answering a question in the chat. It's like, this game doesn't use jump scares that often. Door swings open and I scream so loud that, like, mic blows out. And, like, I whip my headphones off.
Did you play Silent Hill 4, which was maligned? Like, a lot of people.
It was.
I like that game.
The room,
yeah.
I like that game. It has so many problems.
Yeah. Well, what is it? Is it horror? Is it genre horror? Is it just survival horror? You know, all those subgenres. Like, what kind of horror is that game?
Both. It's like, I heard that one of the problems with that game was that it was a different game. That they were like, let's make it Silent Hill now.
It was, yeah. And I don't have enough. It is my microphone. I'm sorry. it's been solved. Now I know when I can use it against the audience. I have not pledged enough fealty to what Silent Hill is to have been disappointed by it. So, like, I didn't play, like, all the first three, and I'm like, what the hell is four? I played two, which I loved, and then four I really liked because of how it inverted, like, your apartment that you're trapped in is the safe space, and it's one of the only places you can save, but you got to venture out into Silent Hill, and it's a shitty time out there. But then your apartment starts getting haunted, and now you hate going back there because you don't have a weapon in your apartment.
Those ghosts are the worst.
It's so bad. Like I got to the part where the fridge starts meowing, and I was like, no, please, please, no, not that.
There's an old Atari game that does something for Night Stalker. It's also like an arcade game or whatever in a television, but it's a game like you run out and shoot stuff, and there's scary monsters that are coming, you have to fight them. Scary game as a kid because you start in this really safe place. You can always run back in there and you're invincible. But after you get a few levels in, it starts decaying and then it's gone.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I turned the game off. I was like five.
Oh, man.
I would
do
it today. I would turn that off.
You guys play Eternal Darkness?
I liked it. It's a horror genre game, but it's not really a horror game. Like, it wasn't scary except as a story, and the insanity things were fun. They weren't scary so much as really interesting, in my opinion.
I think they were scary, but that's fair. I feel like I approach horror games where I'm like my reaction to a scary idea is like, oh, not like, oh, I'm chilled. I have to leave now. But like, I had read, because I liked it a lot, and I loved the sanity effects stuff there. And I had read a fact about it that's listed them, where they tried to be definitive about it. And one of them, which I never encountered, and might have even been invented, was that one of the main characters, like you'd be going down a hallway, and just randomly one of the main characters in the extreme foreground, like superimposed on top of the game, their head would rise up and they'd go, and they'd wink at you, and then go back down. And I was so terrified that would happen. Because I'm questioning, it's not like, it would have been one thing if a face came up and yelled at me. And then I think it would have angered me. I would have been like, that's cheap. But now I'm questioning what that behavior is. Like, why did it wink at me? Yeah.
Well, I only played a little bit of Eternal Darkness, but the impression I got and from its reputation is that it attacks the player along sort of a meta axis.
Mm-hmm.
Where it's just like,
it's
trying to, you know, spook you directly. It's like,
yes.
Oh, why is it deleting my save files?
Oh,
like,
my God, when that happens.
Am I going crazy?
Yeah.
Or is my character going crazy?
Or like they tried to simulate the mute, or like the volume of and they take your sound away and stuff like that. They were very interesting effects. And I like that it's the type of horror where it's not like, you know, some of them were like you walk in and you blow up and you're dead. But some of them are like your character just starts getting very small, and then you just very small and then he disappears. Like where you're questioning why is this happening?
Well, that's a genre of horror. Now, there's a lot of like Japanese horror uses this a lot, and there's a show. It's free on like Crunchyroll. You can just watch it called Yummy Shibai. It's just all short horror fiction, like 5-minute episodes. But they're all the gist of all of them is you're an adult. And something a little bit weird like that happens. And you're rationalizing to yourself that there's no way that could have actually happened. And that is why it gets you. Like, it keeps getting increasingly dire, and the characters are reacting the way we all would. Like, you open a copier, and you see a face, and it's screaming at you, and then it's gone. You're not going to say, well, I guess there's ghosts, and push that out the window and call the police. You're going to say, that was my imagination, and turn your back on it.
Yeah.
Or maybe back out of the room, because you're a little cautious.
You know what that actually reminds me of? It's not a video game, but it's a movie. I think it's called The Troublesome Man or The Bothersome Man. It's real scary, and in a really subtle way. Because, like, this guy shows up in this town, and everything's perfect. Like, they give him a job and an apartment and all this stuff, and he's just, like, going about his business. And he's like, this is really nice. And then just very gradually, he starts to realize that things are messed up. And you know, it starts with little things, well, actually big things, where, like, he glances out his window and there's a dude who's, like, jumped off a balcony and is, like, gored on these, like, railing spikes. And there's some dude just sort of, like, cleaning it up like he doesn't care. And
it's a living.
And he starts to realize that, like, he can't feel things normally and nobody else can. Like, he meets this guy in a bar who's just, like, in the next stall and is, like, there's something wrong with the liquor here. I drink and don't feel anything. Like, I don't get drunk. I don't feel anything. And it's just, like, keeps going. It's really good.
It's I love that kind of stuff. I wish video games did that more often, actually.
I do,
Silent Hill does a lot, but
Yeah.
That's one of the few franchises that I can pinpoint. It's like, it progressively gets creepier in pretty much all of them.
Kentucky Route Zero had a little bit of that. Like, it got creepier as you went further in. Like, little trappings of horror and, like, little, like, you're wondering what
the... Just the Thief games kind of did as well. The original Thief games.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I like
Fatal
Frame.
Oh, Fatal Frame.
Oh,
man. Well, you want to talk about the opposite of a jump scare. Fatal Frame is a game where there's ghosts.
I feel like they still count as jump scares.
They do jump scares. Like, you know, in the most recent one, or maybe the one before that, where there's, like, a room and there's a dressmaker's doll. And when you raise your reticle, its head just pivots.
Yeah.
And it's just subtle enough that you're like, did I see that? Or am I going nuts?
Yeah, there was this one plot in the most recent Thief game, which was, you know, okay, you're in an asylum and you walk into, like, this lunchroom kind of thing, and there's all of these, like, mannequins on a stage who are posed in certain ways. And you walk in there, you see them there, but then if you turn around, they're all posed differently. And then you walk out. That's it. That's all that happens. Nothing in that room attacks you.
I'm so
the mannequins just move. And I was like, I'm out. They move.
It's one of those things that, like, is almost overused, but I still really love it. Just anytime I see mannequins, I'm like, I'm about to have a just like that.
I think I have that from Kingdom.
I'm going to stop trying to pick it up from the exposed wire. I think that'll be really intelligent. You played, what was the most recent Batman?
Arkham Knight?
Yeah, it was Arkham Knight. Did you notice those effects there? Like, there are billboards that when you look at them, when you glance at them, like, instead it's the Joker's face. It's the whatever.
Like, that's cool.
It is a little bit, but it's not like, it's like an ad for a car and, like, a smiling guy in there. And then it's not like now it's the Joker's head.
Oh.
It's like now the man in it is the Joker.
That's
and it's
cool.
Really,
that's
really
clever.
Subtle.
Yeah.
And when I first saw one, I looked away and went back, and I did it a couple times to see if it would trigger, and it did.
That's very cool.
But I would not have noticed it otherwise. It's such a subtle touch.
That game wasn't fantastic, but the whole Joker slowly seeping into Batman is very, very cool.
Yeah,
because that's more of a
was awesome.
That's like a literary trope of his obsession with the Joker and, like, the feedback
Ooh.
Loop. Lit crit coming in here.
Yeah. That damn tech, though.
Actually, of all things, I saw a lot of cosplayers. Undertale, you know, super popular recent game. It has, there's parts of the game that do that. Like, I'm not spoiling anything about the game, but there's a very sinister story in the game if you play it. Like, it is a dark, serious, really sad game. I cried, like, a lot.
I haven't played Undertale yet. It's only, like, 6 hours long, right?
Yeah, it's like,
it's
imagine...
really good. I haven't beat it either, but I'm like, I need to go back to this when I have enough spoons to tackle that task.
It just unfortunately doesn't look good. It really doesn't look like an inviting game. Everyone says to play it, but based on the way it looks, I'm like, I don't really have interest in it.
Yeah, everyone I know, they're like, oh, it's just some JRPG, right?
Yeah.
I don't want to grind for 40 hours.
There's much more to it than that.
Yeah.
But it does that, so...
I gave it a 10.
So it's the sinister, like, there's a sinister, sad story there, and you're playing the game, and it's, you know, it's doing its thing, and you see, like, a little flower appear somewhere, and you're like, was that a glitch? And you think it's just, like, this 8-bit glitch that's happening, and then you start to realize what's going on, and then the game's really creepy. And then at the end of the game, now I'm not going to spoil anything, don't worry, there's a horror scene where it gets really creepy, and it does a lot of those horror tropes in an 8-bit, like, really simple, well, 16-bit looking simple game. You're in a bathroom. And you know there's a thing you need to get in the bathroom. All the clues told you.
Wait for a baby to laugh.
So there's a, like, the curtains are closed, and there's, like, this thing. You can't see what it is, but it's moving back and forth real slowly, making this, like, noise.
Nope.
And if you, as you walk closer to it, your character moves slower and slower, it starts moving faster and faster, like, what?
Nope.
And you have, you have to go up there if you want to get the key.
I mean, you could always lie down and stop breathing.
Yeah.
that's an option.
You could just start living
3 feet
away from it.
Where there's a lie down and cry until you pass out. It's like, boom. Good night.
No, play Undertale. You want that existential, literary, like, there's a horror story that happened in this game. That game is really good.
It's for the panel, myself included. So, like, one of the things is this revisiting of these types of, like, VHS artifacts, 8-bit, stuff that looks like 8-bit, but and then you have these, but the glitches are used in a certain way, right? Do you think that these things will remain frightening, or are these developers, they're just playing with things that we remember from our childhood? Like, there will come a time when you know, somebody playing would be like, "What is? Why are there lines on this? Mm-hmm. Like, why is it like the other like Undertale? Like, why is it so blocky? I don't want to play this."
It's,
you know,
I don't know. It's weird to try and predict how these sort of what are essentially artifacts at this point are going to go further. Like, you know, the icon for a phone on your phone, and it's
yeah.
like a Bakelite receiver.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just the icon for a phone, but it's like nobody uses Bakelite receivers anymore.
Yeah.
Or
you know?
Clockwise. Like,
or
what's
like
clockwise mean?
The save symbol. Like, I saw, it was like
yeah,
a tweet or something.
Floppy disk?
Yeah, somebody
yeah.
somebody was holding up a floppy disk, and the caption was like, "Lol, someone printed out the save button."
Of course.
I'm not that old, am I?
I think there's some things that will remain scary, but a good example is like the first Doom. When I played that, I was really scared. I don't think that's scary now. Like,
mm-hmm.
playing that now, it's, I don't know, it doesn't have any effect on me really at all. It's just like, shoot stuff, yay!
Yeah.
But I think I think that's probably because of the graphics more than anything. People can't relate to it. And then if Undertale is creepy, it's creepy in a tone way,
mm-hmm.
which I think is something that will last
yeah,
for a very long time.
The storytelling is the scary part,
yeah.
not
yep.
so much the graphics.
But the artifacts, I think, might hang around, too, because that all, like, it comes out of Creepypasta, which, that's a young man's game, the Creepypasta world. Like, that's younger
yeah.
than me. And the fact that Creepypasta 8-bit stuff is popular among people who were born long after Final Fantasy VI and VII came out, I feel like those artifacts are going to continue to be brought forward into the future.
I wonder if it's just like, you know, the old dusty tome of forbidden knowledge only transplanted to, like, a more contemporary setting. It's just like the VHS cassette that you watch it and then you die a week later.
Yeah.
You know, it's the same kind of thing. It's like this old format thing that has like forbidden evil or something in it.
The sonic.exe file that you run and then Sonic comes into your room at night and kills you.
Do you think that those artifacts will upgrade though? This sort of
as time goes on.
Yeah.
They
may
start.
You think, like, load times are
going to
be the new spooky thing?
Well, this is my head. It goes backwards.
What's happening?
And then it starts to bleed up the side.
That's what I mean is, like, will these things still be useful? Like static, which we remember as a scary thing to look at. Yeah, there's no static anymore. It's just a blue screen that says line, you know, input
yeah.
or whatever. Like, they took it away from us.
Just made me really sad. We want R.I.P. static.
Goodbye, static.
We'll be missed.
But we do have garbled screens.
Yeah,
because video cards are
like
kind of
JPEG type. Like,
yeah, like video cards are super glitchy now just because, you know, we're pushing them so hard. So you get like those weird visual artifacting, like the textures are all wrong.
Mm.
Like that's going to keep happening for another couple decades.
Maybe the next bargain to come out will use more contemporary glitches. Like you'll have an NPC that just like turns into spaghetti and like crab walks after you.
That's actually, I want to see more stuff use that. Because like we've seen like.
Use spaghetti?
Like, yeah, I'm so hungry, you guys. you know, like like Skyrim and Fallout 3 glitches, where one character's like, "See you later," and then he just starts to spiral
yeah.
into the sky. But it's never been like used as a device.
Yeah, imagine
yeah.
a game like that where that was engineered.
Yeah.
Like it looked like a normal game, but then the game itself just starts to fall apart, and maybe the NPCs like are vaguely aware of it. They're like, "We are dying."
Yeah, that would be a very.
I feel like Oxenfree kind of does a good job of that. Where, you walk into like a certain area, and then you'll keep walking, and then it'll just loop you back to the start, and then you'll do it again. You'll be like, "Is this broken, or is this meant to be happening?" The first few times that it happens, you're like, "I don't understand why it just keeps looping me back," and it's like. Effective because you don't realize what's happening. And it's similar to like Batman Arkham Asylum, which I didn't particularly find scary. Had cool moments with the first time you encounter the Scarecrow.
Mm-hmm.
It's like Batman starts coughing, he can't use detective mode, you walk up to Commissioner Gordon who's on the floor, I think it's Commissioner Gordon, and he's like dead or something, and then you try and walk into this room and then you walk out of the room and it takes you back into the same room and you're like,
yeah.
"Oh my god."
Yeah.
And there's like another part where it makes it look like the game's broken, like I think it's something to do with poison ivy and the screen just kind of like greens out or something. And it uses things that you would identify as like, "Oh, the game's not working. Why can't
right.
I use detective mode right now? This
that
doesn't make sense. Or why is the screen going green?"
I do like geometry-based scares, which Layers of Fear uses to great effect, where it's like you enter a room and then you turn around, the door's gone.
Mm.
You're like, "Uh oh, That's bad. There was an excellent scare, which is one of my favorites, from like a weird game. It was like a Half-Life 2 mod called Underhell.
Oh.
And it was like Fear, but a mod. And there was one part that I really loved where you're in a sort of a nightmare sequence-ish, and there's this long, dark corridor, and you walk to the end, and it's a dead end. So you walk back, and it's also a dead end. And then you walk back again, and you gradually become aware that the corridor's getting shorter until you're in a cubicle, and then darkness. And then the thing
then
happens.
Darkness.
It's just like...
And then it says, thank you for playing Under Hell to unlock.
No, there's a very...
DLC now.
There's a very similar mod. If you all probably own Half-Life 1, but it's called Elevator Source. And it's just you and a bunch of friends, you have to play a multiplayer. You're just in an elevator. You get into it, and it goes down. It stops at places. And it's funny at first, like, oh, it's Jurassic Park and there's dinosaurs out there. But then at one point, a character gets on the elevator with you. And just stands there.
Is it the one who's on fire?
And then, like, he's just standing there at first. And the game goes on for a little bit. And then at one point, the lights go out. And then it comes back on. And there's just a skeleton laying on the floor.
That's still funny.
It was funny, like, 10 seconds after it happened. But it was frightening when it immediately happened. Because it was, that horror trope where you look at something, like the door. And you look away and you look back and it's different.
Mm-hmm.
And our brains are keyed to say something's up when that happens.
Yeah, see,
yeah.
Actually, then you went did a good job with that, too. That same level... The only one that's creepy and probably the only good level in the entire game is the asylum, and there's a part at the end of that level where you're trying to get out of it, and if you walk forward, you'll end up like having your path blocked, and when you turn around, these things that were like far away before are facing you, so it's like it forces you to turn around a lot, and every single time you do, it's kind of like the Weeping Angels from Doctor Who, you know, that every single time they're going to be standing right there.
Right.
And Arkham Knight also did that with the part where you're as the Joker and you're shooting these statue Batmans.
Yeah.
Like, I tried really hard to get out of that part, you have to have Batman catch you. And I tried so hard not to let that happen by running in circles, and I think I was going to have like half an hour just shooting Batman, like, no, I'm going to get out of this room. Didn't happen. But anything that like tricks you into looking behind, and I think it's that sense of dread that makes that really effective, and also more effective than just a random jump scare because you're anticipating it. If you know that something is going to be behind you, or if you know that, I mean, that's why Slender's so scary as well.
Yeah.
It's like he could be anywhere at any time. What if he's behind me right now?
And then the fact that...
A cubicle building where you're like, he's going to be around one of these corners... Everything is screwed.
Yep, and the fact that you're the one, like, you have to turn around to look at it to make
yeah.
it happen. When you do the action that causes that scare,
yeah.
your brain decides that it was your fault. Like, that is part of human psychology.
I think that's the advantage of video games over other forms of media, is that, like, you become the character that all this stuff is happening to. So, like, your experience is, in
yeah.
some ways, unique. You're just like, ah, and then a thing happened to me, not this poor bastard I'm reading about.
So I thought that I hated horror games for a really long time, and then I started reviewing games, so I had to play a lot of them. And I, for ones that were particularly scary, I had a lot of jump scares. I would just sprint everywhere. So my theory was like, well, if I'm moving really fast, then nothing can jump out at me. So I would just run through everything that I possibly could, which actually worked, because I think a lot of what makes things scary is you approaching it slowly because you're feeling cautious. You try and take that away, then it's not half as scary. When I was playing Alien Isolation, the start of that game was terrifying, and that game's complete trash. But it was like, I tried playing it with the music off at one point, and that stopped it from being scary completely. I mean, it also meant that I would die, because I couldn't anticipate when the alien was near me, but it wasn't scary even in the slightest without sound. It was just nothing.
Well, because, you know, we talk about, like, horror game and then, like, genre horror stuff, like the accoutrement of horror. But those are a big part of horror. Those cause those feelings of dread, like the leitmotif of Jason when he's coming in the woods and those kinds of things. They key us up.
Not an actual stab.
You
coordinated
that really well.
You
rehearsed that before?
Yeah, I have practice.
We're
going to
now have a performance of classic themes.
We just want to really talk about sound. How important do we think it is in horror?
The most important, I think.
Well,
because we're not at the level where VR is like 100%.
You know what?
I was playing the kitchen.
Which?
The kitchen?
Never heard of it.
PlayStation VR?
No. Oh, I feel like, so VR is an entire other thing,
yeah.
where like everything
is scary.
Well, yeah, everything I'm talking about now, I'm like, I don't startle, so none of this will frighten me. I feel like I don't know how I will be able to play any VR horror games.
Even stuff that looks bad, because
yeah.
a lot of VR games do look fairly bad, is still scary because you can't separate yourself from it in any way.
The scariest,
any comfort.
The scariest VR game I played, it was a demo I got a few packs ago. It's a guillotine simulator. And all it is you're someone, like, people walk you up and put you down,
yeah.
and you're looking around, and then the guillotine
happens.
Yeah,
I've done that.
And then when they, and in the demo, they guided me, and they literally, like, oh, I guess mine does it too. Like, they, like, people grab me by the arm, so it's tactile, because they know how the game goes, and they put me on a chair like this, and I feel that.
Oh, that's
yeah.
great.
It's awful.
Like, people could not take it.
Yeah. Sorry, before we leave the topic of sound design, did anybody play Dark Echo?
No.
I think that game would really emphasize how important sound design is, because there's almost no graphics. It's this top-down game, and the only display you get is sort of like radiance coming out from noises you make that reflect off of surfaces.
Oh, that game!
And it shows you, like, you detect your surroundings and threats within them entirely by sound. So you can clap, and it sends out a huge ping that echolocates off everything.
That's
and,
cool.
Like your footsteps make similar noise and reflect things. And then you start encountering enemies that can hear you.
Right.
So you have to find your way by making noise, but not so much noise as that they find you.
Ooh.
And it's all like really good atmospheric things, and like you can see. Like dripping water sort of manifests as like these little blue radiance coming out, and you can sometimes see things and like flies, like little black ones. It's
That's really,
really
cool.
And
yeah.
cheap. I mean, yeah, I think really the only reason Alien Isolation is scary is because of sound, and that the sound causes dread. But then, like Silent Hill PT, the reason that I could talk about this game, the reason that you know that there's a threat there is because of sound. So my response to that was never to be scared; it was to just stand still. So it's
yeah.
like that, the sound in that isn't particularly scary, it's a warning. So I feel like different games use it really, really differently.
Well, like Five Nights at Freddy's, I pulled all the tracks out for that video I did, and like had all the different like soundtracks and things, and I did some spectral analysis, and you can see that, you know, the game's really simple. It's one screen. You can't ever move. You just sit in a room the entire game. So the soundscape, like one of the tracks, is this ambient sort of like background noise that the phase is moving around like this the whole time with really wide stereo separation. It makes you feel like you're in this huge, huge building.
That's cool.
But then there's a fan in the room with you, and it's making noise, and it is center channel right in front of you, and never moves, never changes at any point in the whole game. So you have this sound that's like this constant safe sound that's very close to you and never moves, and you have this like amorphous nothing out there that you can never see except through the cameras.
Mm-hmm.
When the monsters move, they kind of move like stereo sound or whatever, but then when the power goes out, like if you mess up, the fan going away is the most terrifying thing that happens in that game. Because that sound, like, you don't even notice it's there until it's not there anymore.
Like,
and then your brain, yeah, your brain freaks out.
Yeah.
That's an argument that sound design is super critical. Like, provided that you understand that it is. Because I could see a lesser developer being like, yeah,
yeah.
a fan in the room and, you know, a small room, I'll make it real reverb-y. And
see, me as a developer, I think it's way cheaper to do sound really well. So you can buy a lot with not a lot of budget to make cool stuff happen in a game. Like, if you wanted to make that whole building as a 3D walk-around game, that's like three more people on your team now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's also just like taking away a sound is the same as taking away a light. I remember this first part, a part in the first Bioshock where I think you fall on someone and all the lights just go out. And
yeah.
I had to move. Like, I know that I had to like look for whoever that was, and I was like, well, it's pitch black, I'm not playing this anymore. And I actually just walked away for quite some time and was like, nope, not doing it. It's like anything that takes away your orientation, which I guess sound can do really well, makes things terrifying. It's
yeah.
super unsettling.
Well, it's sort of like, so the challenge then, for a game like in Bioshock, you're like, well, I have to keep going. Like,
yeah.
I'm going to have to do this. But in PT, where it's like the cue lets you know that something is ahead.
Mm, makes you stop.
And you stop, but now you have to decide whether or not you want to see it. And
yeah.
And as the player, you may be like, eh, it's getting too intense. Like, rather than being forced to proceed, you have to decide whether or not you want to
continue
and witness it.
But it's still continue or stop playing the game.
Yes.
I'd rather it be choosing not to continue is a choice in the game that has other consequences.
Like a different route to like a different ending or conclusion?
Yeah, which that costs a lot of money to make usually for a big game. But that's the dream.
It would be great, though.
Yeah.
You know, you think the path of least resistance. And
the game is like a Netflix-esque, like, are you still there?
Actually,
you want to go, it starts putting up hint cues, like, no, keep walk in there, see what's in there.
Undertale kind of does that.
It's like, go on, go in there, come on, you'll love it.
It's like, the baby needs help. You hear the cries? Get to go in there.
Do you hate babies?
In Far Cry 4, you can finish it in like 20 minutes by just hanging out in the room when he asks you to.
I did the right thing.
And I went to shoot rocket launchers.
Do you think that I'll phrase it this way. I think we're fortunate to live in a time, this just kind of came up at the beginning, when we can explore a lot more experimental types of games.
Yeah.
Whereas you mentioned, what was one of the games? Because the one that's coming to mind is Undying. Did you ever play Clive Barker's Undying?
I did. It ran really badly under emulation, and it was cool. I was like, I bet in the 90s this was amazing.
Yeah, I liked it a lot, and the reveal was so shitty at the end. Sorry, we haven't cussed the whole panel long. But like, I had this other idea of what Undying was about, and, and the scenes and all those stuff kept fitting my model, and I was like, this is amazing.
Yeah.
And then I got to the end, and I was completely wrong, and my idea was so much more scary. But at the end, you have to fight a big monster, and there's a lot of combat. But here's the thing. Back then, I feel like they were making games, and like, well, there has to be combat. Like, nobody's going to play a game where you have to walk around. But now we live when, yes, that is a game, too. We can do that.
This leads neatly into something that I was really hoping to talk about, which is, like, how much gameplay you want and what kind of gameplay you want to put in a game. And I'm actually of the opinion that there's sometimes, like, too much, and they're sort of obligated to that. Like, you know, horror games are sort of expected to be video games first and
right.
horror second. So you have lots of combat or lots of puzzles. And
shout out to The Witness.
Yeah.
Richard Garfield gave us a lexicon to solve that, though.
But the thing is that, those obligations, sometimes they work. Other times they just generate frustration. And frustration will kill horror atmosphere like that.
Yeah.
Like, if you get mad at a game, you can't be scared of it.
Did you say that you had played Soma because this came up? Yeah.
I really, really liked Soma.
Yeah.
That was a game definitely more on the sort of, like, disturbing existential horrors end of the spectrum.
It
like,
does have some combat, though, doesn't it?
Yeah. There are some monster stuff.
I really
want to
play it.
It's real good. It's real.
It's
it makes you super uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Yeah, the ideas are great, and you get very uncomfortable, and it's stuff that like follows you out of
yeah.
what it means to be a person.
What's like an example of something that's particularly creepy in that game?
So
that isn't spoilers. Oh wow.
Yeah, that's
like I heard something about you just walking into a room and there's just dead bodies everywhere, and you have to inspect them or something.
Well,
there's a room where all these like
decapitated people. But
is that
really like
fun?
Was that like that?
Oh yeah, there's one later.
How about this one? Like, there's a lot of unsettling philosophical like concepts in the
like
game.
Transhuman creepy.
But one of the characters or one of the enemies that I was the most afraid to go up against is the I forget its name. But it looks like it's a guy in a diving helmet. It's like a nude man who's got this weird organic diving helmet looking object on his head. Huh? In Soma,
wait,
yeah.
Was it the one with
he can teleport.
Eyes?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he can teleport if you look at him. Otherwise, he walks around, and you know you have to.
I like that because it's like if I stare at my shoes, I'm fine.
Well,
maybe.
If he sees you, it's still like if you get too close, it's a problem. Yeah, but the issue I have with that is that I did get frustrated, and ultimately, I thought that the act of taking away my ability to look at him. Was a good way to keep him mysterious, like forbidding me from actually observing.
Amnesia did the same thing. You can't
yes.
look at the monsters.
Yeah.
You've got to look away from them, which
yeah.
made them so much more terrifying.
But in Soma, it got to the point where the way I believe that he worked was that, you know, he walks at a certain speed, and then when he sees you, he would jump. Like, he'd lose, like, and I believe that he was at a running speed, But it was still, I'm only able to see him when he gets to this position or this position. But I think he can just teleport to you. And I had been in that same little closed space with him for, like, I don't know, I had died like 6-7 times. And all the mystery was gone. I'm like, let me just get it, and
that's,
I'm done.
That's why alien isolation got bad. Is like, at the start, the alien was super mysterious. You didn't know how it worked. And then it was because that game, I feel like they planned a really good, like, 6-hour game. And then we're like, oh, this is too short. People are going to be really mad. Hashtag the order.
Yeah.
And then they dragged it out and made it super long. But by doing that, you automatically figured out how it worked and how it would get you and exactly how to manipulate that. And there was also some parts in that game where it just, like, completely got rid of everything that was scary by making the alien walk on a track. You'd be like, okay, well, I'll just wait for it to go around that corner and then I'll walk forward. And you're like, that's not scary at all anymore. Yeah.
Anytime you smash your head into a brick wall or get into a routine, it gets boring or frustrating, and then you're just, like, not scared.
Oh, yeah.
It's like, you get killed, it's like, okay, we gotta do this part again. Oh, I got killed again.
I forgot about the other frustrating thing about that Soma enemy. And I think they all have a sort of shared, like, don't really look at them. That one in particular.
That sounds really cool, though. You're saying it's a flaw, but it sounds awesome.
No, it's a great idea, and it's a game that's definitely worth playing, and I really do enjoy it. But the other thing that it does is that if you're not allowed to look at it, you are looking at the wall or the floor, and the textures aren't super. Like, it's not compelling. And I've literally got to the point where I was like, I've been looking at this kind of junky wall texture for 20 minutes. And that was what was frustrating me.
You know what might be really good? I heard about this mod, and I kind of wish I'd heard about it before I played it. All it does is de-aggroes all the monsters. They're still there. They're still creepy and weird, but they don't try to kill you. And
yeah.
You can actually come up, and in some ways, it sort of, I think it's intended to change it, where it's just like, these are like weird, creepy, haunted things that are like, you know, you don't know what they want. They have this sort of like familiarity. It's like, they're looking at you, like they think they should be doing something, but they
yeah.
don't, and you're like,
the slices in Bioshock 1 and 2 would have been way cooler if that were a thing. Like, if they like wanted to attack you but didn't and just followed you around.
I keep waiting for someone to make a horror game where it's zombies, but they're not trying to eat you. They're just really sick and sad and upset.
Yeah.
And sort of coming after you. Like,
should come
like
to San Francisco.
But they're coming after you because they need
something.
Well, then
they come after
you because
they're
gonna
eat you. They have this, like, faint memory of, like, this human connection, but they don't remember it, and they get, like, frustrated, and, you know, they
yeah,
die.
That gets under my skin a lot more than the assault stuff. Not that I don't enjoy zombie games, but, like, a friend in college had presented this to me, and he said, so, you go into a building that used to be a restaurant, but everybody, like, the chef died. You see the ghost there. It's the ghost of the chef. He's standing over the old stove where it was, and he's still doing the same thing. There's no food. There's nothing there. He's just still doing the same thing. What's scarier, that he doesn't break from it, or that he sees you and then he attacks you? And I said, I think that just doing it over and over is scary because, like, maybe that is going to be what happens to me. And where I draw that line is that if I'm in a house and there's a ghost and it looks at me and then it disappears, I don't have a clear line of action for what I need to do. If the ghost attacks me, I sell the house. Like, I know what I have to do now, and
I do it
right away.
This
you know?
Is another fantasy of mine is, like, I want to play a ghost game where, like, it's mysterious and you're not sure what their intent is, and it ends up, like, you help them move on eventually. But, like, some of them are, you know, like,
trying
to...
Murdered Soul Suspect kind of tried to do that.
Which one?
Murdered Soul Suspect.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But it was kind of like a movie where you hit buttons to make the game progress.
Yeah, absolutely. The interaction in that game was dumb. But you're a ghost, you can't just interact with everything. But it's like you helping weird ghosts who might be, like, missing a limb sort of get out. And they're all creepy in that they're just dead and they have these... That game was bad, so maybe in a different game.
I mean, it might just be that I'm super sick to death of, like, perma aggro monsters. And it's just like, I have one way to interact with you, it's I'd like them to behave more unpredictably in a way that you're like, I'm not sure what this thing wants.
Well, you all sort of addressed this directly. Like, everyone basically said something to the effect of, sometimes these horror games get too caught up in being a game.
Yeah.
Right.
And that's where the whole Richard Garver, like, he uses the term ortho game to talk about, like, competitive, you know, that, like, that kind of game. And we get, for game designers at least, we can talk about other kinds of games instead of using that super overloaded word game. Because that's why, like, Gone Home, everyone said, oh, it's not a game. It's, yes, it's a game. It is a game.
Did
game
you play it with a keyboard and a mouse?
Yup.
Did you buy it on Steam? Was there a screen involved?
There's no HUD, though.
So, like, Richard Garfield used ortho game to refer to, like, those competitive games. So I've seen more and more people using idio game to mean, like, a personal experience game. Like, a game where you have chart a course through the game, and, like, you have an experience as a result of it that's unique to you or in some way personal. So then we can avoid the guy who says, oh, well, that's not a game, or it's just, like I just said, it's just a movie. It's not actually a game. You're just hitting buttons to make the movie happen.
That's always been the thing that really haunts me about those discussions, is somebody's like, it's not a game. It's like, okay, well, what is it? It's not a monkey. And they never have an answer for what it is.
He's right.
Or
not a monkey. Damn.
Or they'll suggest something that's like a horrendous mouthful. It's like, it's an interactive art experience. It's like, no one's going to call it that.
I just don't know why it happens, you know?
Well,
yeah.
Just telling the ESA is not the ESA is not the video game whatever. It's the Entertainment Software Association.
Huh.
This is all entertainment software.
That's cool.
Or eSoft for short.
Yeah.
That's what the kids call it.
It's gonna catch on.
Hey kids, you want some
eSoft? Yeah, keep away from my child. How are we on time?
We got like 40 seconds left.
We're at time. All right.
Okay, I guess we're out.
Goodbye.
Thank you very much, everybody, for attending. Do we have enough time for everybody to say what their products are, where we can find you?
Oh, so I have little cards here. If you don't watch that video essay I talked about, it's an hour of me, like, digging into the deep weeds of Five Nights at Freddy's. I got a QR code here. And I have a panel tomorrow at 1 in the same room on writing game rules.
Mamma
mia.
Cool. And congratulations on getting
that
panel.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
I feel like I'm an adult now.
You went well.
It finally happened.
You're finally an adult.
Other URLs? Anybody? Anybody?
Yeah.
You
what
can
we got
find twitch.tv/loadingreadyrun. I really hope I got that right. Because it might be loadingreadylive. I don't know what my stream is.
You guys
are
your branding.
I'm
just
figuring
control.
Out which one. Either one of those. And Friday evening at 7 p.m. PST. They'll let us know.
Yeah.
With me and some other poor schlub.
Well, good. You might be a Chainsawsuit. There you go. What is your thing? Give me your thing again. You talked over you, I'm sorry.
What's that?
I talked over the one thing you said.
What is that, like some kind of video game?
Are you
game?
All right. Thank you, everybody.